this week's program, our friend, Father Ron Lillard, talks about the reasons for priestly celibacy. And our very own Trent Horn gives us tips for defending the faith. Catholic Answers starts right now.
I've often said it's okay to make mistakes. It's just not okay to refuse to learn from them.
All right.
That's the thing. Right. We will all make mistakes. We cannot treat evangelism like trying to keep our baseball average up. It's not like, hey, I'm batting 300. I'm batting 330. You know, I don't want this to go down, so I'm going to sit out a few games.
Yeah.
We don't want to make it so, hey, I've had these great interactions. I'm not going to risk having a bad one. That's not what God is calling us to. God does not call the equipped, he equips the called. And part of the way he equips us is he just has us go out there to share the faith and learn from each of our interactions. And as long as we're willing to learn and be corrected and be humble, then we're still going to be doing the Lord's will. We're not doing his will if we, out of pride, don't want to talk to people because we're worried about looking dumb or embarrassing ourselves.
Yeah.
And at the very least, even if you don't know what to say, you don't need to have the right answers. You can just ask people questions. Why do you think that? How do you think that's relevant to what the church teaches? What would make you reconsider the Catholic faith? What's the ideal way the Catholic faith ought to be lived out?
Yeah.
And would you want to be a part of that if it were authentic? Going down that route.
Okay. What do you do if, and I've had this happen quite a few times, especially with the younger generation, when you start sharing the faith and whatnot, and they go, well, the Bible's irrelevant. I don't believe in the Bible. I have my own Bible. And they won't even listen to you twice because the Bible is not a relevant book to them anymore.
Well, I guess I might ask them a question. Why isn't the Bible relevant? What do you see as something that you can't learn from it? And what do you mean by your own Bible? Like, is it because the Bible was written a long time ago? Is it because it contains stories of miracles? I would first want to get to the root and say, what is it that you think makes the Bible irrelevant to your life? They might say, well, it was written a long time ago, but that doesn't mean that it's irrelevant. There's lots of things that were written a long time ago that still matter for us. The works of ancient Greek philosophers that talk about the virtue of democracy or of sound governing in political structures or of how to lead a ethical, fulfilling life were written thousands of years ago. And yet they're still relevant to us today. Like Aristotle talked about how when we're trying to choose to do good, we should always strive for the golden mean. You know, sometimes with our virtues, you know, with courage, that's always the golden middle ground between being cowardly and being foolhardy and charging into danger without caring. So, you know, there's something written 2,500 years ago that still matters today. Why wouldn't you give that same deference to the Bible and what it teaches? I might also ask them, what do you think the Bible teaches? And why is that not relevant? Then finally, I might ask them, do you think the Bible is not true 100%? So do you think there was no ancient Jerusalem? There's no Pontius Pilate? There was no Jesus? No first Christians? Why do you think that that's the case? Do you deny all of ancient history then? That seems kind of anti-intellectual to do that. Or instead, what's the most basic things out of the Bible you can agree with? So I might try to find common ground with them. Could you agree in Leviticus 19? The book of Leviticus and talks about love your neighbor as yourself. You know, Jesus taught the golden rule, but he was quoting Leviticus. You know, finding things in the Proverbs and Psalms people agree with ethically. Do you agree there was at least a Jesus and he was crucified? Who do you think Jesus was? So I might try to start with a very kind of minimal facts approach. Is that helpful, Trevor?
Oh, yeah. I like them ideas.
All right.
The question is I understand, you know, why meaning isn't offered to non-Catholics. What I'd like is clarification on why the sacrament of confession couldn't be offered to a non-Catholic. That's it, simply.
Okay. Well, in principle, confession is available to all baptized non-Catholics, provided they meet certain requirements. One of those is they have to share the faith of the church in the sacrament. So, you know, if they just don't even believe in confession, they don't believe this is going to do anything, well, it is a sacrament, and they shouldn't be receiving it if they don't understand that God actually does work through this. And so because different groups of Christians who are non-Catholic have different attitudes towards confession, that results in different criteria applying to different groups of non-Catholics. In the case of Eastern Orthodox, they share the church's faith in the sacrament of confession. So actually, it's very easy for an Eastern Orthodox Christian to receive confession. Basically, all they need to do is ask. In the case of someone coming from a Protestant background, Protestants generally do not share the church's faith in the sacrament. And so that prevents most Protestants from being able to receive it. Also, because of other differences between the way the Protestant community has evolved in the last 500 years and the way the Catholic Church has progressed, there are a few additional requirements, like someone coming from a Protestant background not only needs to consciously, explicitly share the church's faith in the sacrament that this God really can forgive me through this, but also there needs to be some kind of imminent need for it. Either danger of death would be one kind of grave need, or there could be other kinds of grave need, and they'd need to not be able to approach a minister of their own communion for the sacrament. And that actually is pretty easy to fulfill, since most Protestants don't practice this at all.
Yeah.
But basically, the church does want to make this sacrament available to everybody that genuinely needs it. So if there's a grave need, a Protestant can receive this sacrament. At the same time, the church wants to protect the sanctity of the sacrament by not giving it to people who don't recognize how God is working in it.
Where do we get our data about the afterlife? You're going to be talking about it for a whole hour. Where do we get any information we have about the afterlife?
Well, ultimately, we get it from Jesus. It's a part of Revelation. Okay. So there is one or two or a few things, I wouldn't restrict it to one or two, but a few things we can know about the afterlife by the natural light of human reason, namely that the soul continues to exist upon death.
Okay.
So that's something that we don't need divine revelation to give us knowledge of, although it is a part of divine revelation. But that's something we can come to know philosophically, that the soul is immortal by nature and thus subsists and can continue to exist after death. Beyond that, it's pretty murky waters by the natural light of human reason. You know, would the soul be able to engage in intellectual activity by its own natural powers without the body, apart from divine grace? Philosophers kind of go back and forth on that. Some say, no, it's going to require divine grace and a light of glory in order to exercise its intellectual capacities. Other philosophers might say, no, it would be able to do so even without the body. But it's a lot of gray area concerning exactly what the afterlife would be, what the experience of the soul would be apart from divine revelation. But in divine revelation, with the revelation of the Father through Jesus Christ, we have Jesus revealing to us the reality, ultimately, of heaven and hell. So he reveals to us about the heavenly existence, you know, eternal life he speaks of in John 17:3 is to know you, Father, and the one whom you have sent. So there is a revelation that eternal life is this knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ. In our tradition, we call it the beatific vision, where we will have an intellectual knowledge of the divine essence and what God is. On this side of the veil, we only know God by a concept. It's not immediate. It's mediated through concepts, right? It's not a direct knowledge of what God is. We know that God is by the natural light of human reason. But we don't know what God is in his essence on this side of the veil. We're going to need some help. God's going to have to give us some extra equipment to the mind in order to elevate the intellectual powers, in order to see him face to face as Scripture speaks of it, this beatific vision. And vision is being used there as a metaphor for knowledge, right? Because we even use that in common parlance. You know, when you come to understand something, hopefully you understand what I'm saying, you might say, oh, I see, right?
Oh, yeah.
We
right.
use sight as a metaphor for knowledge. And so and when Scripture speaks of seeing God face to face as that which constitutes heaven, that in our tradition, we understand that to be the knowledge of God's divine essence. So that's what heaven is, this beatific vision from which flows this everlasting beatitude or happiness and satisfaction, because we're united in knowing and possessing, right?
Yeah.
The very infinite good and infinite truth that we naturally long for, that God created us for.
It seems like when Jesus says something, just one sentence like that, about to know you and the one whom you sent,
right,
that then that leaves us in the position of applying our reason faculties to that
to unpack it,
and it unpacks into this.
Right.
It may seem like very little knowledge, but it actually imparts to us a great deal by implication.
That's what we do in theology, right? Yeah. Theology is the application of reason to the deposit of faith, to that which God has revealed to us,
right,
in order to meditate on it, contemplate it, and unpack it. What those things that Jesus said and the implications of them. That's what we do in theology, and it's been enshrined in the teaching of the church, etc. Now, the counterpart of heaven is obviously hell, right? And that's something else that Jesus teaches in a definitive way in several passages. For example, in Matthew 7, 13 through 15, he talks about enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. So Jesus clearly articulates these two different paths, one to eternal life, one to eternal destruction. One is wide, the way to destruction. One is narrow, the way to eternal life. Many go to destruction. Few go to eternal life, right? And there's a big debate about the many and the few. But we have this text here where Jesus clearly teaches there is a state of destruction in the afterlife. And of course, other passages would be like, for example, in that same chapter in Matthew 7, 21 through 23, he says, you know, on the day of judgment, people will say to me, Lord, Lord, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. On that day, he says, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evildoers. So Jesus is teaching us that on the day of judgment, there will be a definitive separation from him with those who are evildoers who ultimately reject him and do not do what he says to do, although they're saying, Lord, Lord, right?
Right.
They're not doing the will of the Father and obeying God, and so consequently, they're definitively rejected. And I think ultimately, the key passage is in Matthew 25, 31 through 46, that great passage about the last judgment, the sheep on the right, the goats on the left, the sheep go to eternal life, the goats go to eternal damnation. We have several aspects here revealed. That there is a state of eternal life and damnation is revealed. That there will be some who go to eternal damnation at the end of time is, I would argue, a part of the revelation. Jesus doesn't speak in a hypothetical. If there are goats, they will go to eternal damnation. He says there will be sheep and goats. It's of a prophetic nature, right? And so, and then elsewhere you see also too, like in John 5, Jesus talking about how all of the dead shall rise, right? Both the righteous and the unrighteous. And the righteous shall go to eternal life. The unrighteous shall go to eternal damnation or, you know, eternal torment. And so there you have revelation of how there will be souls in hell at the time of the general resurrection at the end of time.
Yes.
Coming out to receive their bodies and being cast into everlasting torment. So those are a few passages where Jesus reveals to us the reality of hell, which, as the Catechism teaches, is a definitive self-exclusion from God, where a person dies in that final state of choosing something else as their final goal to latch onto for the rest of their existence,
right,
as opposed to God. And that's the epitome of evil, right? To ultimately reject God, the true good, the truth and goodness itself,
right,
for some lesser good or something else.
Nah, I don't want that. I want
that's
this.
That's right. And attaching to that lesser good. And so you have the epitome of evil because it's ultimately rejecting God.
The glorious French Revolution went...
sometimes called the Terror.
Yeah, right. I was trying to have a little bit of sarcasm, a little irony maybe, became utterly murderous over a period of days in September. And among the killed, priests and bishops. So we remember them as the martyrs of September, or martyrs of the September Massacre. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened, who they were? Well,
the French Revolution started out in a way which maybe Americans wouldn't find particularly strange. You know, people making appeals for their rights against certain abuses that prevailed under the crown. And so they finally managed to call the parliamentary system of, it's not really the parliament, it was the French parliament, it was something else, but let's just say their legislative body, to deal with some of these things. And they got certain concessions and improvements, which even Catholics, many of them anyway, had no difficulty with at the very beginning. This is in 1787. I can't remember exactly the year, but so much so that like a very unimpeachably Catholic author like Hilary Belloc was all in favor of the French Revolution as it began, and he has a very sympathetic treatment of it. If you want to read a conservative Catholic view that's sympathetic to the revolution, read Hilary Belloc's French Revolution, The French Revolution. But then as mob rule took over, it's kind of like the difference between the old Democrats and the new Democrats, you know, just not to be too dramatic, but I mean, that's basically the way it is. You know, there was some like reasonable people, interested in working class people and their needs and whatnot. And now it's become kind of a ideological thing for many of them in any case.
Right.
At least in their public image. So then the revolution devolved into a wholesale attempt to overthrow traditional French society in its entirety, and resulted in the deaths of thousands upon thousands of persons, violent and peremptory, without decent trials. And it was the first modern revolution, which we've seen many in the 20th century.
People just tearing each other apart.
It was terrible. This movement, it changed from something which seemed sort of reasonable to something which was just completely irrational and violent and terrible. And then it had its effects throughout Europe through the reign of Napoleon. And so anyway, that's sort of the very broadest little picture.
But before Napoleon, we have the figures like Robespierre.
Well before. I mean, Napoleon's in the early 19th century, so it's right there within a decade. To continue the revolution and spread its ideas throughout all of Europe as a constitutional form. But the persecution of the church, which began there in France, led to the wholesale attempt to submit the church to the control and authority of the state. Yeah. And so they demanded that the clergy take an oath accepting a civil constitution and the state's control of the church, trumping that of the bishops and of the pope. And of course, many, many of the clergy, in fact, most of them, just refused to do this. Mm-hmm. And so then they were going to be subject to not just civil fines or exile or losing their position, but to imprisonment and to martyrdom. And that's what happened in these September days.
Now, this is somewhat similar to some of what we see in communist countries even today, this idea that the state needs to control everything.
Everything, yeah.
And if you can have your church, but it will be under the control of the state.
Right, exactly.
Okay. Yeah.
And that's been a difficulty since this period all the way to the present. It starts with the popes after the revolution with Pius VII and Napoleon, and the concordat with the church, and it's now extending now to the situation in China. So we can't be too hard on the popes because they're trying to make sure the churches are open.
Yeah.
And of course, wholesale slaughter, although it might bring about a lot of glorious martyrs, it also brings about a lot of terror and people weakening the faith and abandoning it. That's also another evil. You know, it's too much of a burden for ordinary people to bear. But in these days, in September, the clergy, and Paris was full of clergy. It was Paris, there was the great university, the Sorbonne, the great medieval university at which St. Thomas Aquinas taught,
right,
and was the glory of medieval France.
Which had previously been called the University of Paris.
University of Paris, which is called the Sorbonne. It's the University of Paris. There were tons of clergy there. Paris was like Rome, you know, because the clergy were everywhere because they're getting their degrees and whatnot. And so they rounded up secular clergy, that is diocesan priests, canons regular, such as I am, of St. Augustine, for example, and then also monks, and then sisters, and others who refused to go along with this civil constitution. And they were killed, over 1,000 in at least in all of France, over 1,000 in the course of 3 days. But among the clerical and devout religious who were killed in Paris, there are about 192, and I think elsewhere it goes to about 300 or so, but I'm not exactly sure of the number. And of course, the list which the church uses to beatify and canonize people, they have to go on concrete evidence, you know, linking name to story, and so it can be particularly difficult. But we can assume that the numbers are far greater than what we actually possess right now. So they were rounded up, the priests were rounded up and brought to the Carmelite convent. And convent, in traditional Catholic language, you don't need to think of the little building next to the school or something. A convent is any religious house. And of course, some of them were quite large enough to house a lot of people or push a lot of people in. So they were rounded up, and then they were simply executed continuously for 3 days. There was a bit, I've been there to the Carmelite establishment there in Paris, which is right by the Institut Catholique, the great Catholic university there in Paris now. And they were simply taken to the garden in bunches, and they were bayoneted, which means they were just stabbed to death and shot. And then their bodies were piled into piles of, you know, people. And then the soldiers who executed them in hatred of the faith, they had to take, you know, breaks, because this killing that many people is hard work. You know, it's not hard to kill. I mean, it's not easy to kill a human being. It takes a little effort. And so they would take their little break, and they would go up to this little refectory where they would eat and drink. And then they had their bayonets, and they would lean them up against the wall, and then the blood would drip from the bayonets down the wall. And so they preserved that room. It's called the Salle des Épées, the room of the points of the swords, that is the bayonets. And they covered them in glass, so you can see, even to this day, you can see the wall where the blood was just dripping down. But then later, when there was a Catholic restoration in France, fairly quickly, a little brief Catholic restoration, and then under the different Napoleonic regimes and different French regimes in the 19th century, some pro-Catholic, some not, the place was turned into a little bit of a shrine. So there's the room where the soldiers rested their bayonets, and where you can actually see the blood of the martyrs. Exactly. But then downstairs, they took the bones of the martyrs who had been just buried in a mass grave, and they enshrined them along the walls of this crypt chapel. And so you go in, there's an altar, and then these beautiful cases that are filled with the bones of the martyrs. Wow. So you get a really catacomb effect, you know. Yeah. So you see that, you see the 190 or so clergy that were killed there, and some women religious as well. And then also their blood. It makes quite an impression on one.
Hi, yes. I was once told by a priest that the reason for celibacy was that in the Middle Ages, when a priest died, their children would come and close the church and try to claim it as their inheritance, so that families were discontinued and then caused them to be celibate after that. And he also told me about something he called the Lutheran loophole, where because Lutherans believe the same as Catholics, that a married Lutheran priest could come into the church married with children and be accepted fully into the priesthood. I wondered what you knew about that.
This seems like your friend didn't quite get those exactly right.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that first historical circumstance. I mean, it may be true that there were some problems. There are obviously, if priests are married and have families and wives and kids, there's a lot of just plain practical considerations and difficulties that would arise, especially concerning property and money and so on. I don't think that's the reason for the celibacy as such. It might have helped to move things in that direction, but
there is the witness of Jesus and St. Paul.
Exactly, right? So, you know, I am called father. I hope to be a good spiritual father to the children that God gives me. And, you know, I serve them and our dear Lord, right, by belonging wholly to Christ, as St. Paul, when he speaks of celibacy or marriage, he says that a husband has to look first to his wife, the good of his wife. That's how he serves her, and that's wonderful. That's how he serves God. But as a priest, I couldn't imagine how married clergy do it, to be quite honest with you. It seems to me, and I'm talking, you know, those who in the Eastern Rite, there are some married clergy and so on. The demands of the priest are tremendous, and to have a family on top of that would be very difficult. But I think more to what Cy was saying, you know, our conformity with our Lord, right, our desire to belong wholly and completely to him, I think this is really at the forefront of it all, or certainly should be. And also, I think just on a practical level in our own times, I don't think there's going to be a restoration of any proper sense of purity without celibates. You know, the world needs to see that, no, this is not, you know, it's often people think, oh, this is impossible. You must be an angel, or, you know, no, you've got to be cheating or something. But no, I mean, none of us are saying it's difficult. Our Lord, you know, didn't say, hey, this is going to be easy.
No.
Right. But as we say, there's a traditional exhortation at marriage, you know, in the traditional rite where the church warns the couple and says, what you're about to enter into is difficult, but with love it's possible, and with much love it's a joy. And so too with celibacy, right? To belong wholly and completely to Christ, right? What portion of the Holy Land did the Levites get?
They got the whole thing.
Or
they got none of it.
They got none of it. Yeah, because what was their portion?
Yeah.
God himself.
Yeah, yeah, I see what you mean. Yeah. You know,
celibacy is not a negative thing. It's a positive thing. It's a magnificent thing.
Thanks for watching Catholic Answers. Join us on our live radio broadcast every weekday from 3 to 5 Pacific and 6 to 8 Eastern on EWTN Radio or the EWTN app. Find more videos and live streams on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/CatholicCom, or find us on Facebook simply by searching Catholic Answers. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations, and we'll see you next week on Catholic Answers.